Afternoon to all of our friends who are joining us from the comfort of their homes from this fourth transmission live from the city of Oaxaca, Mexico. My name is Hector Torres, and I would like to introduce Teresa Diaz, the owner of the art gallery Red Dot, who is co-hosting this event with Isai Cervantes, who is a friend and collaborator of the Oaxaca Learning Center. I will be moderating this program entitled Fundraising Through Art. The goal of this and the upcoming events is to present an offer for sale the work of Oaxacan artists and to raise funds for the TOL campaign. We would like to quickly meet those of you who are connected online and find out where you are joining us from. So who wants to introduce himself, herself first? Someone? Robert, we cannot listen to you.
Hi, my name is Robert Anion, and I'm the president of the Friends of the Oaxaca Learning Center, and I'm glad to see everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm calling from Northern California, a little village called Mendocino, and I have two other friends here. That's so nice.
Okay, thank you so much, Robert. Someone else?
Hi, I'm Susan Connor. I'm calling from the main building of the Oaxaca Learning Center. I live and volunteer here for a time. And I'm director on the board of directors of the Oaxaca.
You're on. I joined
Thank you so much, Susan. Here with us, we have two of our students from the Oaxaca Learning Center. So I want to give the floor to the students so they can present themselves.
Join without video, but I don't know if the audio is on.
Entonces, los estudiantes, si se pueden presentar, por favor. Okay, thank you so much to our students. We have some more people, so someone else who wants to introduce, to be introduced. We have to Carla, I guess.
Yes, hello, I'm Carla. And so nice to be here. I was in Oaxaca last year before the pandemic. And now I'm in Dublin, Ireland.
Oh my goodness.
I've been wanting to come because I get the emails from Teresa, and she was my yoga teacher and more than that, a wonderful friend. And Oaxaca's got a warm place in my heart and art as well. So, hola.
Hi, and welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Hey, welcome. Is someone else who wants to introduce himself, herself? I guess there's not, right? Okay. We would also like to greet to our in-person audience that includes friends from the US who are joining us for this wonderful afternoon. The fact that all of you are joining us in this program means a lot to us because you support the development of Oaxacan youth and have an interest in Mexican art. On June 1st, we started the series of events with a transmission entitled Online Kickoff Party. In that event, we explained in detail the objective of this alliance between the art gallery Red Dot and TOLC, and how, by purchasing art, you can support both the artist and the learning center. On June 11, in our second transmission entitled The Taste of Art in Oaxaca, we had the valuable participation of two artists, Sigrid Vise and Samuel Rojas. They explained the techniques that they used to realize their artistic visions and inspiration. On June 19, in our third transmission entitled Polemics of Visual Arts in Oaxaca, we had a valuable participation of another two artists, Virgilio Santaella and Judith Rios. They explained the techniques that used to realize their artistic visions and inspiration. This board transmission is entitled Masters of Inspiration in Oaxaca, and we will hear details of the TOL campaign and learn about the activities of the Red Dot Art Gallery. We will also hear from two artists who are joining us for this event. You can post your questions in the chat section during the program. Remember, at the end of the event, we will have an answer session where we can answer to your questions. Now, I would like to introduce Teresa Diaz, the director of this project and owner of the Red Dot Art Gallery. Teresa Diaz is a museologist with 27 years of experience working with museums, galleries, artists, collectors, and other nonprofit organizations. Her heart has always been in education through the arts, history, and science, and with youth from disadvantaged communities in the United States. Since she arrived in Oaxaca 4 years ago, she has organized yoga classes to give greater access to all and help build community. At the same time, Teresa has sought collaboration with local artists who she felt were working in a unique creative genre. Now, she has realized her dream of opening her own gallery and serving as a resource for other artists, art students, and beginning collectors. Teresa's mission for the gallery is to open new avenues of creative output in Oaxaca by organizing and developing programs that address contemporary themes of importance. She also hopes that youth can be inspired by participating in these programs and follow artistic directions in their career and life. Teresa approaches to work collaboratively to help fund her projects. At the same time that she is promoting the work of the artists whom she works with, she is opening up new experience for the staff and students of TOLC and beyond. It has been a great learning experience for all of us.
Hello, everyone. Welcome. And it's really good to see you all again and to see one of them, a special student, Carla. And thank you again for supporting us. We will be talking, I won't be talking about myself nor the gallery this time. I want us to go ahead and go through our program. And I'll introduce, Hector will be introducing the artist, Esteban Urbieta and Roman Yaguno, the Oaxacan artist. And they will be talking about their life, their work, and also the theme of who are these masters of art in Oaxaca? Why are they considered masters? Why do they follow them? Why do we collect them? So that's going to be pretty interesting.
Okay, thank you so much, Teresa. Now we will hear from Isai Cervantes, who will tell us about the TOLC campaign.
Hi, good afternoon, and thanks, Hector. Now, it is important to say that Hector was also a student and teacher at TOLC, and now he is the coordinator of the Friends of the Oaxaca Learning Center. I want to thank our students that join us today for this event. Their being here reflects the interest that they have about the amazing art of Oaxaca. We have started our campaign called Juntos Construyamos Historias, Together We Build Stories, because we want to raise funds to build classrooms on the second floor of the building that we own on Murguia Street. This project will help us to improve our sustainability by allowing us to focus more funds on student needs and to reach more youth. As soon as the pandemic lets us, we will continue with our face-to-face tutoring and advising services, but we will continue also working online to reach out to more students. We know that if we apply technology and innovation to our services, they will have a greater impact on Oaxaca youth. Finally, with this project, we will also improve the organizational operations of the Learning Center, having all our activities under one roof. We invite you to take part in this campaign. Please visit the websites of our partners in Canada and the United States and find out how your financial support will allow us to continue helping students to transform their lives, creating more successful life stories and helping them to reach their dreams and goals. And now, we are pleased to share with you the testimony of an excellent education professional and future master in pedagogy, Maria Garcia, who was a student in our student support group project for 4 years. And she's here to tell us how she benefited from the services of the Learning Center. We are grateful for her support in our campaign. Thank you and enjoy today's event. Welcome.
Yo soy Mari, soy licenciada en educación bilingüe, actualmente maestrante en pedagogía en la UNAM. Hoy puedo decir que mi desarrollo profesional y personal se lo debo gran parte al Instituto de Integración y Asesoría Comunitaria, pues me ayudó a conectarme con el mundo real y a ser mejor persona, sobre todo a través de sus cursos de ortografía, de psicología, redacción de textos, inglés, computación y otras actividades y programas a las que asistí. Actualmente sabemos que hay muchos jóvenes que necesitan potencializar sus habilidades para ser mejores seres humanos. Así que les invito a todos y todas a que formen parte de este maravilloso proyecto del Centro de Aprendizaje. Juntos construyamos historias. Tu donativo puede cambiar la vida de un estudiante. Ayudemos a cambiar vidas. Ayudemos a que la educación llegue a todos y todas. Porque como dice el gran pedagogo Paulo Freire, la educación no transforma a la sociedad, sino que transforma a los individuos que transforman a la sociedad.
Okay, welcome here again. I would like to introduce to you Maestro Román Yaguno and Maestro Esteban Urbieta, both artists, are Oaxacan artists. They're going to be talking a little bit about their life. And Hector is actually going to be reading the biographies of both artists, please.
I said I am going to present to these two people, to these two artists that we have today, Esteban Urbieta and Román Yaguno, who will talk to us about their art and today's topic, Masters of Inspiration in Oaxaca, together with Teresa Diaz, who will provide translation. Now, I will tell you about the first artist, Esteban Urbieta. Esteban Urbieta is born on September 13 on the year 1973 in Juchitán de Zaragoza. He grows up assisting his father in his auto paint and body shop, where he learns to assemble different scrap parts, welding them together, creating art without knowing it. At the age of 17, his family meets the architect Álvaro Guerra Torres, who, impressed by his assemblages, takes him under his wing to the great city of Oaxaca to follow his passion for art. In 1998, Urbieta enrolls in the Casa de la Cultura Oaxaqueña, the Culture Center for the Arts, and his talent provides him a scholarship at the Rufino Tamayo Plastic Arts Workshop. He excels as an outstanding student of Japanese master Shinsaburo Takeda. There, he also practices formal painting techniques, sculpture, ceramics, vitreous, enamel, and learns Japanese techniques from Yasushiko Miyazaki. In 1999, he is accepted as an exponent for the first biennial of painting and engraving, Paul Gauguin, organized by the Autonomous University of Guerrero. With his diverse and experimental techniques, Urbieta explores themes and relationship between humans, animals, and nature, drawing inspiration from the folklore of his native land of the Isthmus of Tehuantepec. He relates this in the harmonic, maternal, and loving dialogues. The tree, a symbol of the family, is a central part of his colorful work. The woman, a ship that carries life, is portrayed as fertile,
always surrounded by a vortex of fish and birds. In the more contemporary series of 8 works, Bird That Sings Inks, Urbieta presents a monochromatic palette of ink, pigment, and coffee with egg tempera and paper. His colorfully intrinsicate paintings of the series Chrysalidas embodies the femaleness of life with images of repeated busts with wings, butterflies, and flowers intertwined with meandering paths. His newly assembled screen-printed, literally illustrated booklet, Rituales Nocturnos, featured collaborations with poets such as Edgar Saavedra and Javier Palau Hernandez. His works are part of important collections in Oaxaca and the nation, as well as in the US and Europe.
Okay, maestro, puede platicarnos un poco de su vida, cómo se relaciona su vida, su arte, por favor. He's going to talk a little bit about how his life is related to his work.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Bueno, buenas tardes. Antes que nada, agradecerte, Tere, por la invitación que me haces. Y pues es un honor a mí estar acá contigo y pues platicar un poco acerca de lo que yo estoy haciendo en proceso, ¿no?
He wants to thank everyone, and then he wants to thank me for inviting him to talk here about the process of his work.
Bueno, pues bien, creo que cuando inicio en la pintura tiene que ver mucho mi entorno, ¿no? El hecho de haber nacido en Cuchitán tiene que ver la situación de que la misma convivencia con el color, con las imágenes, todos esos recuerdos, todos esos elementos me ayudaron mucho para iniciar las temáticas en mis pinturas como inspirado sobre todo en la mujer, ¿no? Que es una fuerza que traía en el hecho de estar cerca de un mercado, que mi madre, mi abuela eran personas que estaban cerca del mercado, ¿no?
He is explaining that the influences of his work are the influences, the environment that he grew up in at the instance of Juchitán, the colors, the flavors, the animals, the flora, but especially women, because he grew up near a market where there were lots of women that were participating, especially his mother, that would come to this market.
Así es. Mi proceso fue poco a poco avanzando. Cuando yo llego acá a Oaxaca, pues ya tomo el interés más formal en dedicarme a la pintura. Hubieron muchos cambios precisamente porque yo soy, por mi naturaleza, inquieto en el sentido de que constantemente ando yo buscando qué hacer en la pintura. No me conformo siempre con lo que yo tengo, ¿no? Soy en ese sentido un poco rebelde. Entonces, la temática que yo venía desarrollando era una temática, de cierta manera, de mi entorno. Pero poco a poco fue evolucionando o cambiando, rompiendo con esta idea de los personajes que yo traía. Como por ejemplo un personaje que recuerdo mucho que era una mujer, una juchiteca cargando una iguana que precisamente está retomado de una fotógrafa importante.
Esteban says that he was a very restless youngster and he was always kind of experimenting with the tools that he had in various forms, and that's what he has kind of dedicated his art career in sort of taking on different types of themes and different types of ways of expressing. And he says that in his environment, one of the characters which he was very inspired by was this was these women that would carry iguanas on their heads to sell. And of course, one of the most iconic representations of this is the photographer Gabriela Iturbide. Anyway, go ahead.
Bueno, de esos elementos que fueron retomados, ahí fueron como que rompiendo esa temática poco a poco para ir construyendo nuevos lenguajes, ¿no? Que era mi intención y pues actualmente ya ha habido un cambio, ¿no?
Well, so he has been taking on like these themes on and on, but changing them constantly. And this is what his work is mostly about this changing, ever-changing ways of expression of these very personal images.
Thank you so much, Esteban and Teresa. Now it is time to hear from our second artist, Roman Yaguno. I want to remind you that you can write your questions in the chat section during the program, and we will have an answer session at the end of the event to answer all of your questions. Now, Roman Yaguno was born in 1959 in San Juan del Estado Etla in Oaxaca. He encountered the world of art in El Centro de Estudios de Arte in la Ciudad de Oaxaca, where in addition to the introduction to the visual arts, he took interest in art history. There is where he discovered the artworks of Rodolfo Morales and the linkages with French Impressionism and the literary works of the magical realists. In his work, you are witness to a poetic form of expression that is evident in his imagery, reflecting the voice of traditions, the importance of family, and his close contact with nature, bird songs, cosmology, and storytelling. His career and work has been prized by the Children International and the Art Museum Carrillo Gil, among others.
A esta charla.
He wants to thank us and thank me for the invitation.
Y pues comentar acerca de mi obra, porque los artistas tenemos muchos pretextos para empezar una obra, ¿verdad?
He wants to talk about his work and he says that artists have a lot of excuses to begin a new work of art.
Sí, en este caso mi trabajo está compuesto, o digamos que el tema recurrente es la familia.
His theme, his recurrent themes of his work is the family.
Sin dejar de lado la cuestión rural. Yo nací en un pueblo y pues todas las mañanas el campesino va por las cosas para sus toros, vacas, todos los animales del campo. Y eso es un pretexto también para mí para ponerlo en la obra.
So one of his inspirations, the daily inspirations while he grew up in this very rural town in Oaxaca, was watching and observing the men that would go out to get food for their cows and their goats and chickens. And so that is really a part of his inspiration is that those moments.
Sí, y hay muchos motivos, digamos, para construir una obra, ¿no? El color es muy importante, pero la interpretación que da el artista a cada cosa es la que le da el carácter personal a la obra. En este caso, yo puedo ver un árbol y lo interpreto a mi manera. Estoy copiando algo natural, algo que con la vista, ¿verdad? La tengo muy aguda todo el tiempo y la mente para que yo me lleve esa imagen y después la pase a la tela.
So his inspiration is always color and it's always, for example, the nature beings in his work. For example, when he goes out and sees a wonderful tree, he keeps that image in his mind and then he goes back to his studio, to his painting, to paint that representation, which he also adds a lot of his personal interpretation in these images of nature.
Sí, el color para mí no me importa, ¿no? Yo no tengo una paleta, digamos, muy estudiada o, digamos, una paleta muy limitada. Yo como viene en el tubo, el color, así lo aplico, hay muy poca mezcla. Lo que pasa es que yo me gusta que impacte el color porque siento que el color es el que da alegría a la obra.
So he says he's not very learned in with color. He just has a very very basic colors, but then he actually gets inspired by the color itself to interpret an object, like for example a tree, to interpret that object with that color that he has there.
Cuando el artista cuenta con todos estos elementos naturales y el color, la inspiración, y se va a su estudio, es cuando convergen en su mente la imaginación, ¿sí?, la sensibilidad, la interpretación de la naturaleza, ¿sí?, y le va dando eso que ya dije, ¿no?, el carácter a la obra, y es lo que identifica a un artista.
So when he says that when he comes back to the studio, is when his imagination, he takes all these things that he has learned from the outside, and his imagination begins to work, and he becomes a little bit selective of what kind of colors he wants to use, of course. But he also, that's when one artist is able to create, like to imagine these fantastical things in his work, in their work.
Toda esta constante de ver la naturaleza, de ver las cosas cotidianas, es lo que el artista aprovecha para demostrar su lenguaje, ¿no? Muy propio. En esto cabe decir algo que dijo Gustav Klimt, ¿no? Si quieren conocer mi obra, no me pregunten, sino más bien vean mis cuadros.
Yeah, so it's this when his what he's trying to say with all the his his imagination, his colors, his inspiration, it just comes innate in him. He just doesn't think about it too much before being in front of that paper, in front of that canvas. And like he quotes Gustav Klimt saying that, if you like my work, don't ask me about my work. Come and look at it.
Okay, thank you so much, Roman. Thank you so much, Teresa, for this interesting talk. Now we are going to hear from both of the artists on their perspectives of Masters of Inspiration in Oaxaca. Once more, I remind you that you can write your questions in the chat section during the program. We will have an answer session at the end of the event.
Okay, so we're going to open the forum for these for both Mr. Yaguno and Mr. Urbieta to discuss what are their inspirations within Oaxaca and within the so-called. Do they have inspirations in through masters, through other teachers, and then we're going to discuss. Well, who these teachers are?
Bueno, todos los artistas, ¿verdad? Desde épocas muy antes, como que se ha venido uniendo eslabón tras eslabón lo que es el arte. No podemos decir que no recibimos influencias de otros. Estamos bañados de influencias, todos los artistas.
Okay, déjenme poner. So here in Oaxaca, he says that here in Oaxaca, the art world has been actually being built one link, like a chain link, one link after the other link. And that there's not really like a Oaxacan art, is this is more like these artists have been influenced by other artists.
Sí, en este caso yo puedo decir de manera muy personal que he tenido influencias, o me gusta más bien, mucho la obra del maestro Machagall, y me gusta también mucho Modigliani. Yo creo que los artistas tenemos un modelo a seguir, y yo creo que eso lo aprovecho yo, ¿no? Para mostrar mi trabajo.
So he says that ultimately his two main influences is Marc Chagall, the French artist Marc Chagall, and also the artist Modigliani. And those are his two most inspired by.
Sí, yo creo que estos dos pintores, para mí, yo creo que no pintaban con la mano, ¿no? Sino yo creo que pintaban con el corazón. Y sus pinturas son para mí como obras poéticas.
He says that these artists for him represent these two artists that worked not with their hands, but with their heart. And their work is very poetic.
Sí, yo pienso que de ellos me he nutrido más que nada en el mensaje de llegar a alguien, ¿no? Con estas obras que a veces son tan sencillas, pero están atrás de esas imágenes hay algo muy, muy importante que quieren comunicar. Entonces, estos personajes para mí del arte han influido en mi trabajo.
So he says that these artists have a lot of meaning and a lot of depth into what they're depicting, especially the personalities that they depict in their artwork. It's something beyond just an image, and that's what he has been influenced by.
Sí, y no tengo por el momento en la mente de decir quién será el próximo artista que vaya a influir en otras generaciones, ¿no? Sí, porque, como le digo, cada artista viene uniéndose eslabón tras eslabón, y así es como conocemos la historia del arte, ¿no? No está alejada una cosa de la otra, todo se va eslabón.
So he says that he doesn't really know who the next master here in Oaxaca is going to be, or his next master is going to be, like he says. All in Oaxaca, for example, all of these artists are linked together. They have some sort of a link. And that's what he thinks, that that's what the inspiration will be for him. Okay, muchas gracias.
Pues bien, en mi caso, yo creo que cuando yo llego acá a Oaxaca, venía un poco sin conocer precisamente total lo que era el arte sobre los artistas. No me tenía una referencia con un artista que pues es mi tío familiar, que vivíamos cerca de la casa, que era artista, pintor, poeta, escritor. De cierta manera inicié con esa motivación e influencia por él, ¿no? En el sentido de que él me motivó a seguir adelante con esto también en el arte.
So he says that Esteban, when he came to Oaxaca from the Isthmus, he really didn't know many artists. He actually didn't know any artists, but the only artist that he knew was his uncle. His uncle is also a very famous, he passed away, but he is a very famous artist in this area, as well as poet, and as well as writer. And so that he emulated his uncle.
Y cuando yo estoy acá en Oaxaca ya estudiando en la Escuela de Bellas Artes, pues el maestro Takeda fue un referente también, ¿no? En la enseñanza, en la inspiración. Él, pues otro personaje que me impactó mucho, pues yo estaba iniciando en el arte, llegando acá a Oaxaca, el maestro Toledo fue el que me inspiró mucho en su trabajo, ¿no?
Okay. So after he started to go to school here in the fine arts school, he started to be inspired by Sanshiburo Takeda, the artist Takeda, and that was a very plain first inspiration, as well as, and later on, of course, when he saw the work of Francisco Toledo, he became very influenced by his work.
Bueno, en ese tiempo de estudiante, yo venía muy tímido de Juchitán, ¿no? En ocasiones a mí me costaba trabajo irme al Yago, por decir, a leer, investigar, ¿no? O conocer más sobre artista. Era ese temor de acercarme. pero pues conviviendo acá con las galerías, en las galerías los maestros que se presentaban, habían en ese momento estos jóvenes como el maestro Virgilio Santaella, Emiliano López, que me llamaban la atención, ¿no? Alejandro Santiago, que fue uno de los que me impactó bastante su trabajo y fue muy motivador, ¿no?
So when he was a very shy boy or a young man actually, and so he did not know where to get inspiration, who to talk to, who to guide, and guide him. And he was a little bit afraid of going to the Yago Library. The Yago Library is one of the biggest Latin American art libraries in the world. And but as soon when he started to go through it, and he began to also go to galleries. And in those galleries, he met these artists, these like older artists. And one of them is Virgilio Santaella. And the other one is Emilio López. Emilio López. And
Alejandro Santiago.
And Alejandro Santiago, of course, who also passed away.
Y cuando recién empiezo yo a descubrir o entra en el internet, en la información que existe sobre el arte fuera de México, entonces empiezo yo a conocer más artistas, ¿no? Y pues me empieza a maravillar mucho sobre el arte, el arte abstracto, el arte moderno, el arte conceptual, y entonces me empieza como que a inclinarme en ese gusto por ese tipo de arte.
So he starts after meeting these artists and kind of hanging out with them, because he was the young one. He also starts to explore and to see that there's other types of art as well, like types of art and saying not only just representational art, but there's also like abstraction, and there is also different types of abstraction. And so he starts to like open his eyes and be influenced by these currents.
Pues bien, actualmente yo creo que hay un artista que a mí en particular me llama mucho, Miguel Barceló, que es un artista que trabaja con la materia, con la textura, todo este rollo de que vibra su obra. Entonces, a mí esto me ha impactado y de por sí que yo soy un artista inquieto o rebelde en mi trabajo, he estado constantemente en búsqueda, en estar experimentando. Entonces, llego también en ese momento que como que me identifico con ese sentido y empiezo a trabajar con ciertas cosas que son matéricas, ¿no?
So one of the most recent inspirations for him has been Miguel Barceló. And Miguel Barceló's work, he works a lot with natural fibers, natural pigments, natural objects. And so Esteban considers himself a very restless artist. And so he started to be inspired by Barceló's work, to where he's very attracted to experimenting with natural pigment, natural surfaces. I know that he does some ceramic now, and also he paints on a mate paper as well. And so that's what he's starting to do, to work outside of just oil or canvas.
Bueno, pues todo ese proceso que he tenido de descubrimiento del acuarela, el acrílico, las técnicas, todo en ese sentido, es como una experimentación total que yo llevo, ¿no?, a descubrir y precisamente la identificación que yo decía con este artista es precisamente porque mi característica es así, ¿no? Estar explotando en el arte, ¿no?, y dar todo lo que yo puedo dentro de mi capacidad creativa o mi capacidad intelectual que pueda yo tener y demostrar de que pues hay otras posibilidades de poder expresarse, ¿no? Y es ahí donde yo sigo mi camino.
So he's trying to explore other ways of expressing himself through art, through painting, for example, through painting, through printmaking, through drawing. And so that's what he's constantly trying to do, taking Barceló as an inspiration. But I know personally, I know that he has been really trying to break the mold in his artwork, and he's one of those artists that is going to continue advancing with the material, with the subject, with with representing truly what a Oaxacan artist is. Personal nada más.
Sí, sí. Y pues, bueno, en la cuestión del arte en Oaxaca o inspiración que nos pueda dar, yo creo que existe muchas referencias, como artistas como referencia, ¿no? Que te pueden inspirar. Sinceramente, pues también te pueden inspirar jóvenes que están actualmente iniciando en el arte, que están haciendo arte contemporáneo, que tienen una temática o un contenido diferente a lo que se ha dado. Lo que a mí me fascina precisamente en el arte en Oaxaca es esa riqueza que tiene de diversidad, ¿no? En la producción, que puedes ver un montón de posibilidades en el arte, ¿no? Y que te puede maravillar, ¿no?
Sí, one of the things that he observes here in Oaxaca is that all these younger artists are really trying to break the mold, and they're trying to work in their own ways without having to follow like a certain master. And that's what he's really have observed lately, and all these like different artists that are also coming from other places. And that's what makes Oaxaca art what it is.
Y sí, y lo único que como artista, en mi caso, es disfrutar, gozar del arte nada más, y estar explorando y experimentando y dando todo lo que pueda yo aportar en este sentido, ¿no?
So all that he can do is just continue to explore, continue to experiment, and give all that he has as an artist.
Okay. Muy bien.
Thank you so much for the artist for this interesting audio dialogue. Now we are going to answer the questions from our in-person audience and via the chat. But first of all, we are going to start with our students who are joining us online from the Oaxaca Learning Center. ¿Preguntas?
Hola, ¿nos escuchan?
Sí, ahora.
Hola.
¿Qué obra fue que me gustó más, la que localizó usted?
Más. Posible para poder decir sus preguntas, gracias.
¿Cuál de sus obras fue la que le gustó más?
The student asked, from all of their work, which one is the one that they have loved the most?
¿Quiere empezar usted?
Bueno, la verdad es un poco difícil poder decir, ¿no? A lo mejor ya la hice hace como 20 años, o apenas está por venir, ¿no? Pero sí hay piezas que son muy, muy bonitas para mí, ¿no? Entonces, poder decir esta es la mejor pieza o la que me ha gustado más, si la tengo, ¿no? Entonces, es una familia que dos personajes, ¿sí? Dos rostros muy grandes, y en el pecho están estos personajes, están, ¿no? Ahí están mostrados en esa pieza. Entonces, llama mucho la atención, digamos, los rostros de los padres arriba, ¿sí? Los rostros alargados, algo así como les decía yo, como Modigliani, y abajo los rostros de mis hijos, ¿no? Es una pieza que me ha gustado mucho. Y luego todo el contorno lleno de animales, ¿no? Pueden ser luciérnagas, pueden ser libélulas, hay ranas, hay muchos insectos, ¿no? Y también animalitos, objetos. Entonces, es una pieza que a mí me ha gustado muchísimo.
Well, he says it's a little difficult for him to remember what piece it would be his favorite. Maybe he did it 20 years ago. Maybe he did it, you know, a couple of years ago. But one of the pieces that really sticks in his mind is these very these two personalities that he draws, that he paints, a woman and a man, and inside of them all of his children. And it's actually him talking about his family and his children. And then around these really elongated figures, there's all these animals, and these all these animals that actually surrounded his life as well, like frogs and birds and cows and sheep, et cetera. So that's his favorite. Okay, ¿y usted, maestro?
Bien, dice el maestro Yaguno que sí es un poco complicado, ¿no? Decir cuál es la pieza que más me ha gustado, porque sí han habido procesos diferentes, o cada obra es diferente momento de disfrutarlo, pero sí, particularmente, sí tengo una serie de obras que hice que es para mí muy especial y que solamente pues la tengo como colección privada, ¿no? Y esa sí nunca la he promovido, nunca la he vendido y ofrecido. Son una serie de rostros que se llaman rostros andantes. Esos rostros andantes los hice en el 2006, precisamente cuando estuvo el problema acá en Oaxaca del 2006. Pero en sí es un tema muy personal porque yo tenía un problema de espalda y no podía caminar muy bien. Y en ese tiempo el recurso económico no me daba para los gastos que yo estaba generando en la producción y en todo este sentido de enfermedad que yo estaba padeciendo. Yo utilicé un tríptico de invitación de una exposición que me sobraron y sobre ese tríptico empecé a trabajar estos rostros. Y hice alrededor de 100 rostros y creo que cada rostro tiene diferentes personalidades y fue las piezas que más me ha dejado marcado, ¿no? Y las tengo como recuerdo.
Yo tengo el lujo de haberlas visto. Okay, so he says that one of his, you know, it's also very difficult for him to say which one is his favorite, but the one that he really, really loves, and no one really has seen these works, except me. I'm so privileged. Is these 100 plus portraits that he began in 2006 after the conflict happened here in Oaxaca. He actually, he had to like be reclused into his home because he had a back problem and he couldn't really walk and he couldn't go outside. So what he did was he took these invitations of another exhibition that he had done previously that were left over. And in the back of these invitations, he began to paint these portraits. And these portraits are about different people and different faces and people that he's known or heard of in his life. And then he created numerous, like I said, over 100 portraits. And so this is those have been his favorite. Gracias. Next.
Ahora, por favor, el otro. Ahora, bien. Por favor, si el otro estudiante puede hacer la pregunta.
¿Quién o quiénes creen ustedes que los apoyó al inicio de su carrera?
Pregunta.
Bueno.
Voy a traducirla. The question is, who inspired you what inspired you in the beginning of your career?
Bueno, en este caso yo puedo platicar de quién fue la persona que me motivó a desarrollarme en las artes plásticas, ¿no? Yo trabajaba con una señora suiza haciendo diseño para serigrafía y ella vio que hacía yo unos trazos en acuarela y dice, están muy bonitos, dice, deberías de pintar como unos 20, 30 de estos acuarelas y dejarme verlas. Y entonces, pues yo lo hice, ¿no? Empecé a trabajar y empecé a jugar con el color. eran como entre abstractas y figurativas mis acuarelas. Entonces, esta señora pues viajaba cada año a Suiza, ¿sí? Y su esposo tenía un taller enorme de serigrafía en Suiza. Y ella me dijo, ¿me puedo llevar tus acuarelas? Porque voy a ir a Suiza. Y le digo, bueno, sí. Y se la llevó. Pero pasó un año y no regresó. Pasó como otros 8 meses diciendo, pues ya se llevó mis acuarelas y no regresó, ¿no? Pero regresó y me llamó por teléfono a la casa y dice, Román, ya estoy en Oaxaca. Quiero decirte que si puedes venir a las 5 de la tarde a la casa, al departamento. Le digo, sí, cómo no. Y yo iba pues con alegría, ¿no? Y ya me dice, abre esa caja. Y abrí la caja y venían muchos pinceles, muchas tintas, muchas cajas de colores. Wow. Venían muchas cosas. Y también un sobre allí de dinero. Entonces me dije, ¿sabes qué? Tu obra tiene mucho color, dice. Hicimos como un carnaval, en una exposición que se hizo en el taller de mi ex esposo. Y me trajo las fotografías de que esas 20 acuarelas se exhibieron y varios trabajadores de esa fábrica o de esa, donde hacían serigrafía, se vistieron como arlequines y salieron a dar una vuelta a la calle y uno de ellos tenía un jorongo, se llama jorongo, mexicano con mucho color, y ahí iban tocando y entraron y abrieron la exposición.
A ver, voy a traducir porque si no, ya se va a olvidar. Sí. Okay, well, this is a very interesting story, but he says that his inspiration was this Swiss woman who was a printmaker here in Oaxaca for a while, and he was working as her assistant, and she knew that he loved the color, and he said she came and gave him 20 pieces of paper for him to paint on and said, here, go and paint on him. So he brought the 20 pieces of paper, and then she asked him if she could take him back to Switzerland with her. And so she did, but she didn't come back until like a year and 8 months later. And when he was very disillusioned during this time because she thought that he thought that she was gone. And when she came back, she gifted him a box with all these materials, art materials, and of course a little envelope with money. And also these photographs of this exhibition that she had done called Carnival in Switzerland, where she had hung all of his works of art all throughout the gallery, the exhibition, and she and they had and the people that participated were dressed as harlequins, and one of them wearing a jorongo, a Mexican style jorongo, like going through the gallery.
Sí. Y esto me motivó a seguir porque ella me dijo, debes de pintar y pintar más, porque después vuelvo a ir a Suiza y voy a llevar más cosas, ¿no? Porque haciendo un poco a un lado este tema, en la familia hubo muy poco apoyo, ¿no? Muy poco apoyo cuando yo les dije que quería estudiar pintura. Okay. Y la familia como que no ve muy bien esto de la pintura, ¿no? Porque piensan que es muy difícil llegar a realizarse como artista o tener dinero. Y esto no pasa solo en Oaxaca, ¿eh? Pasa en todo el mundo.
And, so he's saying that like after this happened, she inspired him to actually start to paint a lot. So he said, you know, you have a lot of talent, you do a lot of beautiful things with color, why don't you continue painting with a lot of color? And so that's when he started to find out that he really wanted to be an artist, although he did not have the support of his family, because a traditional family does not want their sons or daughters to be artists, you know, of course. So there was a lot of resistance there. Okay. Muchas gracias.
Okay. No, en mi caso, me acuerdo de la primera persona que fue quien me apoyó en este sentido para llegar más al arte, venirme a estudiar. haciendo memoria, yo estaba en el taller de ojalatería de mi padre, que arreglábamos y pintábamos carros. Estaba yo con mi papá, estábamos arreglando un tubo de escape de un arquitecto que se llama Álvaro Guerra. Este arquitecto está hablando sobre, platicando sobre pinturas, estaba con mis hermanos, con mi papá. Y entonces mis hermanos le dicen, no, pues él pinta, ¿no? Yo en ese tiempo tendría como 17 años. Y ella de oficio tenía la hojalatería y pintura. Entonces en ese momento yo siempre era muy chiviado, ¿no? Y mis hermanos van y traen todo lo que yo tenía pintando. Pero yo pintaba sobre láminas con pintura automotiva, sobre láminas, sobre la cartulina que hacíamos moldes de salpicaderas, de cofre y todo esto. Le mostraron esos trabajitos y el arquitecto dijo que pues, él quería llevárselo porque quería hacerle un comentario a un amigo. Pasaron, ¿qué será? Unos 2 meses cuando hablan por teléfono y me dicen de que pues su amigo del arquitecto dijo que pues le gustó mucho y que me apoyaran para tener una beca acá en la Casa de la Cultura acá en Oaxaca. Pero él era el maestro Andrés Enestrosa, que vio mi trabajo y platicó con el arquitecto, no, pues hay que buscarle el apoyo. Y el maestro Andrés Enestrosa hizo contacto con el director de la Casa de la Cultura en ese tiempo y me dieron un apoyo de 6 meses para estar como una beca. Entonces, fue la primera vez el apoyo que yo tuve y fue, digamos que el inicio para, en ese momento, decirle a papá, ¿sabes qué? Yo ya no me voy a dedicar a la pintura, no quiero dedicarme a la jaletería, quiero dedicarme a la pintura. Fue cuando ya tomé la decisión de venirme a estudiar a la Escuela de Bellas Artes, pero ese fue el punto de partida. ¿No?
Yeah, so when he's telling a story of when he used to work with his father in his automotive shop, and they would paint, you know, paint cars and fix everything. And then one time there was this architect that came in to get his car fixed. And, you know, he started talking about like being an architect and what it took to be an architect. And so his father and his brothers actually said, hold on a second. And they went inside of the house and took out all of these little assemblages and paintings and just very creative things that Esteban had done on his own with automotive paint, with this discarded materials from the shop, and also with discarded materials from the house. And so the architect said, well, can I take these? I know who to show them to. So he took these works to Oaxaca, and he showed them to Andrés Enestrosa. And Andrés Enestrosa was able to help him out to get a scholarship at the Casa de la Cultura, exhibit these works actually in the Casa de la Cultura, and then get a scholarship at the Fine Arts School here in Oaxaca.
Pues, podría mencionar también varios nombres, ¿no? Pero sí, se me van a olvidar unas, pero sí han habido muchas personas que pues han sido parte de en este apoyo, ¿no? En ese sentido de que uno va creciendo. Gracias a ese apoyo que nos han brindado estas personas, pues uno ha podido realizarse, ¿no? Dentro de su trayectoria como artista.
Yeah, there's been a lot of people that have supported him during his whole career. And, you know, he could name them, but right now he just wants to say that they're very much part of his career, the success of his career. Is there another question?
Okay. For our students, we want to say sorry because we are rushing with the time. So there are no more questions from the students. We are going to go ahead with some questions that we have in the chat section. So the first question is for Roman, okay? This question is from Carla Freeman. The question is, when Roman said that he inspires his job on nature and gave an example of the trees, are there any particular trees they like to paint?
Que sí hay, como cuando dijo que está inspirado por los árboles, por ejemplo, ¿le gusta un árbol en particular? ¿Tiene un significado ese árbol?
Bueno, sí, yo pienso que la naturaleza es bellísima, ¿no? Nos da todo, ¿sí? Entonces, estamos alimentados, estamos bañados de muchísimas cosas, ¿no?
Ah. Sí, un poquito más cerca.
Ok, bueno, yo creo que esto nos motiva para, para trabajar, para dar de sí los artistas, todo, ¿no? Es importante que nosotros experimentemos las cosas cotidianas, ¿sí? Para que despierten nuestros sentimientos, ¿sí? Y los volquemos o los plasmemos en una tela.
So he says that literally, no, there's not a tree in itself, but he just says that poetically, he actually takes nature and reinterprets it and puts it down in his canvas or his surface. Okay. Muchas gracias.
Okay. Thank you so much, but we are going to finish with the questions. Now I am going to give the floor to Teresa Diaz.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay. Well, I want to thank so much to the artists that were able to have a really interesting talk, very heartful, very poetic, both of them, very poetic. I would like to thank you also for your questions. I would like to thank the students as well for their questions, very insightful questions. All I wanted to just wrap this up with is just that this is really important. We're doing this event in order to sell the work of the gallery and of these collectors like Linda Hanna and this anonymous collector that she doesn't want her name to be mentioned. And also this other artist, Andrew Alsta, in order for us to raise funds for the Oaxaca Learning Center. 10 to 20% of all the proceeds of all the work is given to the Oaxaca Learning Center. And they're really in need of funds in order to continue building their structure, their second floor structure. Okay, so how do we purchase art? That's the question. So there's a lot of prices. They're very different prices all throughout the website. You can go into red.artgallery.com.mx and you can go and look at the gallery sections and choose the work of art that you want to of these five artists that I've selected to work with. Or you can go into the store section of the website and you have all of the works there by category. The first category is the gallery that I work with. And the second category is Linda Hanna's collection. Sorry. The third one is the anonymous collector. And then the fourth is the Andrew Alsta's collection. And just go through them. And just choose your work. Choose your work of art. I will email me. Please email me before you purchase it so that we can agree on, for example, the shipping and handling of the work if need be. If you want it framed or don't want it framed, as well as how would you like to receive it? Do you want me to drop it off if you live here in Oaxaca? Or do you want me to ship it when I go in July when I go to the United States? I'll drop them off personally. Anyway, and also how do you want to pay for it? There's a lot of payment options, especially if you're in the US or in Canada, or if you're in Mexico. And I just wanted to let you know that if you're not able to buy a work of art, please donate money to the Oaxaca Learning Center. They have a website that will be put in a little bit where you can find information of how to do this. But, so thank you so much.
Hector.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Linda Hanna and I've lived in Oaxaca for the past 24 years. Some of you may know me from my B&B, others from my folk art tours. Hello, My name is Linda Hanna, and I've lived in Oaxaca for the past 24 years. Some of you may know me from my B&B, others from my folk art tours. I'm passionate about Oaxaca art and have gotten great satisfaction out of sharing what I've learned with others. Gary Titus, founder of the Oaxaca Learning Center 17 years ago, was also enthusiastic about Oaxacan art, and we shared a number of wonderful excursions together. Gary would be thrilled to know how his dream of helping young students achieve their academic goals has evolved and grown. It is a true Oaxacan success story, and it continues to inspire others. The Learning Center helps students with economic hardship, and at this point in time, there are many more needing that kind of help because of the pandemic. For this reason, we need to make sure that the Oaxaca Center has the funds it requires to realize its goals. That is why Teresa Diaz has organized this wonderful art sale. 20% of the sales will go to help the Learning Center. You, as a purchaser, will be doubly blessed. You will have gotten a wonderful piece of art, and you will also know that you have helped a very valuable cause. I have contributed 19 paintings and graphics that are deserving of a good home. If, however, you don't feel like you can acquire a new piece of art at this moment, I still encourage you to donate to the Oaxaca Learning Center. If you have any questions regarding the sale or the art, please contact Terry Diaz. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for this useful information, Teresa, and also for the two artists that we have here, Esteban Urbieta and Roman Yaguno. Now we want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for joining us for this great event. Follow us on our social networks, Red Dot and Talk, and share them with your friends and family. And remind and invite you to join us for this next event. We will close this cycle of events with a calendar closing afternoon, which will take place the following Friday, July 2nd at 2 p.m. Central Time Zone. We would also like to extend our thanks to the administration and staff of Casa de Barro for all of their help and the use of their facilities. If you're in the city of Oaxaca, we invite you to visit these beautiful facilities located at 703 Reforma Street, Colonia Centro, Oaxaca de Juarez. And once more, thanks to Samuel Aragon for the excellent sound. We hope to see you in our next events. And remember that juntos construyamos historias, together we build stories. Thank you, and until the next time, see you.